Hello, everyone. Today, I'm going to be talking with Professor Ken Hammond about the life and legacy of the famous Chinese revolutionary Zhou Enlai, who was born 125 years ago today, on the 5th of March, 1898. Ken Hammond is a professor of East Asian and Global History at New Mexico State University. He's the founding director of the Confucius Institute at that university, and he's an activist with Pivot to Peace. He's also a member of the Friends of Socialist China Advisory Group and a regular collaborator with us. Ken, thank you very much for joining us today. And let's go straight into the questions. Born in 1898, Zhou's childhood was a time of enormous upheaval in China, with the Boxer Uprising starting just a year after his birth, with, you know, a millennia of dynastic rule drawing to their conclusion, with multiple imperialist powers aiming to deepen their exploitation and protect their investments in the country, with a burgeoning movement of nationalists and anti-imperialists that was gaining ground. What were some of the particular circumstances or experiences that led Zhou Enlai to the cause of Marxism, to the Chinese Revolution? For example, how formative and influential was the time that he spent in Western Europe and his early interactions with the Communist International and international revolutionaries more generally?
Sure, sure. Yeah, I mean, Zhou Enlai's early life is absolutely, crosses some very turbulent times, and as indeed in many ways his entire life does. But that the particularities of that period from the end of the 19th century to the beginning of the 1920s took him on a very, very individual sort of itinerary, interestingly enough. I mean, he, you know, was born into a family that was not certainly at the top of the social hierarchy, but had connections to the old imperial government. Some of his ancestors had served in as officials, and you know, he, as a little boy, got started on the path of a traditional Confucian education. But then in 1905, the old examination system is abolished, and new educational opportunities begin to crop up. When he was about 14, he started what was called Nankai Middle School. It's a little deceptive. Middle school, the Chinese term for middle school, actually means what in the West we generally call a high school. And that institution eventually evolved into Nankai University. And that's in Tianjin on the East Coast, just about 70 kilometers southeast of Beijing. And that was a school that was very modernist, very progressive, but in a very sort of Western liberal kind of mode. So he got exposed to a lot of the, as I say, more liberal ideas and attitudes there. And he was there from 1913 to 1917. And then in 1918, went to Japan for not a little over a year, not a full 2 years, came back in late April of 1919. And it's in Japan that he really begins to be drawn into more radical ideas and thoughts and activities. Even in high school, he had been he was editor of the Nankai Middle School newspaper, or of a paper there, but was interested in some of these progressive type ideas. But it's when he gets to Japan, in part because that coincides with the beginning of the arrival of information about the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia. And he really responds very strongly to that. He writes about the Bolshevik Revolution. He actually, right when it was first published, got a copy of John Reed's 10 Days That Shook the World. He reads that. That has a very strong influence on him. And by the time he returns to China, goes back to Tianjin in April, late April of 19, right on the threshold of the May 4th movement, He's very, very interested in Marxism, in these, you know, more revolutionary ideas. He's not in Beijing for the May 4th demonstration or anything, but as news of that comes to Tianjin, he gets involved with students in the city, and that what has now become, or is in the process of being formed, into Nankai University. He does go to Beijing at one point and takes part in some of the demonstrations, demanding that students who had been arrested be released. And this really, he's beginning to consolidate his views around Marxism in a much clearer sort of way. But that really, really comes together beginning in 1920 when he goes to France. He's not part of the, during the First World War, about 60,000 young Chinese had gone to France to take part in labor activities, sort of work programs. And he's not part of that, but he does go to study, although he also does work. He works for a while in an automobile factory, the Renault factory, one of the big plants just outside of Paris. And that's where he begins to have real concrete encounters with the French Communist Party, with very active Marxist organizers, labor organizers. His time there coincides with that of Deng Xiaoping, who's 6 years younger than him, but also there and also works for a while at the Renault factory. They, along with a few other Chinese who are in Paris, form a Communist Youth League, which is in some ways, it's like a second founding or a parallel founding of the Communist Party. Communist Party in China, of course, is organized in July of 1921. And right around that same time, Zhou Enlai and Deng Xiaoping and others are setting up this group in Paris as well. He spends time in Berlin, meets revolutionary organizers there in between 22 and 24. He's not there the whole time. He's mostly in Paris, but he does go back and forth to Berlin a few times. So this sort of winding itinerary that he has brings him by 1921 to identify himself as a communist, as a Marxist, to be founding this youth group with Deng Xiaoping and others. And it's in 1924 that he's finally ready to return to China. And of course, at that point, he gets involved in the actual organizing activities of the party there in South China to begin with.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And that leads me on to the next question, which is that in the mid-1920s, Zhou Enlai served as director of the political department of the Huangpu Military Academy. He also had a leading role in organizing the Shanghai working class to liberate the city from warlord rule in 1927. And that was, as you know, at the time of the first united front between the Communist Party and the Kuomintang. However, once the right-wing elements of the Kuomintang, which had gained the ascendancy in the party, arrived in the city, they coordinated with criminal gangs and they carried out a very famous, notorious massacre, killing several thousand communists and workers. And that was the start of Chiang Kai-shek's White Terror. Can you give us a bit more detail about Zhou's activities and his role during this period?
Sure. Zhou works very closely with the Huangpu Military Academy down in Guangzhou. Guangzhou was the sort of power base for the Kuomintang. This, of course, is a period where China is fragmented into lots of little sort of local, almost principalities, the different warlords, some of whom controlled maybe two or three provinces, some of them only controlled parts of one province, but there were a bunch of them scattered around. And there was ostensibly a national government based in Beijing. But there wasn't really any real unity in the country, and the Kuomintang had been sort of marginalized to the far south. Essentially, Guangdong and Guangxi provinces were their strongholds. But with advice from the International, who had sent a couple of organizers out there, political and military assistance was being provided, and this was the period where there's a lot of debate and discussion about what the best path forward for the party, for the revolution in China was going to be. And, the International, and you know, the leadership in Moscow, the Bolshevik leadership, felt very much that the working class was not sufficiently developed or large enough in China to really stand as an independent revolutionary force, and that they should have this united front with the Kuomintang, which was seen as essentially the bourgeois party, or at least a party of a sort of national bourgeoisie, right? And Zhou, had to find his path within that. I think that his exposure to ideas in France and elsewhere in Europe had set him up with a fairly broad perspective, and certainly with a strong linkage to the working class parties in the West. And so he seems to have been, pretty comfortable, at least initially, with the idea of the United Front and sort of working to build up the Communist Party amongst the working class, but in alliance with these, perceived at least progressive elements amongst the bourgeoisie. And of course, as long as Sun Yat-sen was around, that was a reasonably viable strategy. It's only after Sun's death, when Chiang Kai-shek emerges as the new sort of strongman, that that things are going to go sideways. So Zhou's role during this period, he's the political commissar, I suppose you'd say, at the military academy, and that's very important because it means that he developed personal relationships, but also served as a political mentor for many figures who in the future would become military leaders in the Red Army, and some even who remained with the Kuomintang. And that was important later in his career when he served as a negotiator, especially during the Second United Front, during the anti-Japanese war, with the Kuomintang, because he had a lot of linkages that went back to the military academy days. When the what's called the Northern Expedition gets launched in 1926, the fall of 26, Zhou moves up to Shanghai, and so in the while that's going on, there's the Northern Expedition was this move by the military led by Chiang Kai-shek to try to reunify the country, to bring this period of warlord division to an end, partly by negotiation, partly by fighting, and simply incorporating new areas into the control of the Kuomintang. And that goes on sort of two lines of march, if you will, one up through central China and one further east that culminates at Shanghai. And Zhou winds up in Shanghai, where the party had its headquarters, and it's, of course, Shanghai was the most industrialized city, and that's where the working class was most concentrated. So it was sort of the natural headquarters or the natural center of gravity for the party. And works closely with the organizers there to prepare for the arrival of the nationalist forces. Because the idea was that if there's no Red Army yet, but if the sort of workers' militias could establish themselves in control in Shanghai, then they would be able to welcome the Kuomintang and the United Front Army into the city. But by this time, Chiang Kai-shek, who had become increasingly anti-communist, had decided that he was going to split with the party. He was certainly very dependent not only on the bourgeoisie, but also, as you mentioned, on these organized criminal groups in Shanghai. And so when the United Front Army is approaching Shanghai, the workers and the party have an uprising, and they're able to establish control in the city. But then Chiang Kai-shek doesn't come into Shanghai. He waits outside and then coordinates with the criminal gangs and with some of the Western imperialist forces. And the workers are massacred. The uprising is suppressed. Lots of the leadership of the party is killed. Thousands of ordinary workers and organizers are killed or imprisoned. Joe manages to not be killed, obviously. He is arrested, but then again, based on some of these personal connections that he had developed as the political advisor at the military academy, he manages to be let go and goes underground and is able to get out of the city. But this was a very dangerous time, obviously. And it ushers in a period of some political difficulty and confusion within the party as to how to go forward now that the First United Front has been blown apart by Chiang Kai-shek.
Right. Yeah, it's an extremely complex and complicated history, and in many ways very divisive. And as you say, you know, planted the seeds of division within the party itself and also within the international communist movement in terms of the differences between the Communist International, which was headquartered in Moscow, and the CPC, you know, differences that would come to arguably, you know, form part of the structure of what became the Sino-Soviet split, which is, you know, one of the greatest disasters that has befallen our movement in its history. So it was also in 1927 that Zhou Enlai first met Mao Zedong, who was obviously a founder member of the Communist Party of China, one of the 12 on that boat in Zhejiang in 1921, and who would go on to become the preeminent leader of the Chinese Revolution and remains today really the central figure in the legacy and the whole history of Chinese socialism. And Zhou and Mao proceeded to work extremely closely together for pretty close to half a century, essentially until the end of their lives. Both men died in 1976. All in all, Zhou Enlai was Mao's closest and most consistent collaborator. What do you think was the political basis for this longstanding relationship, which arguably is one of the most fruitful and mutually complementary working relationships of the 20th century?
Oh, absolutely. Although it doesn't gel right away. It's interesting. Mao, of course, during the First United Front, Mao had been in charge of the Peasants Bureau and had done a lot of work organizing farmers' unions, particularly in central China, in Hunan, which was his home province. He developed his views of the peasantry, of the masses of the farming population, in ways that were somewhat at variance with the perspective of the international and of the sort of the core of leadership of the party. Mao thought of the peasantry not as a sort of petty bourgeois strata that was likely to ally itself with the bourgeoisie, but instead he thought of them as what he called agricultural proletarians, and that is a pretty good reading given the history of sort of commercialized agriculture in China, which goes back for centuries. There was a lot of wage labor, day labor, things like that. Probably the largest grouping of peasants, were not small tenant or small holders, but were small tenants or day laborers, I say, things like that. Anyway, Mao argued that a greater reliance on the peasantry would be necessary in China for the revolution to advance, and that they should be seen not as a sort of alien, mistrusted group, but as the natural partners of the working class, of the industrial working class. But that view was not widely accepted within the party. And in the late 20s, after the split in April of 27, the party had a very difficult time trying to navigate a new path. Different leaders came and went, figures like Li Lisan and Chu Chobai, people who went off to Moscow. Zhou Enlai himself made two separate journeys to Moscow during this period, 1928 and 1930. And it was a time where debates within the Soviet Union, within the international, about the best path forward, about the nature of the revolutionary situation in China. These were unresolved issues, and some of those got bound up with conflicts between Stalin and Trotsky, for example. It was quite a tumultuous time. Zhou Enlai is during this period very active in a lot of underground work. He was a consummate organizer. He was not necessarily doing a lot of theoretical writing, but he was very, very skilled and adept at the management of the work that had to be done, both clandestine and you know, publications and things like that. So he moves around a lot. He's in different places. He's in Shanghai sometimes, but he's also down in Hong Kong and in Guangzhou. And moving around a fair bit. He actually gets married just about this time, a little bit earlier, 1925. He too is trying to navigate these changing times. It's not really until he goes to Jiangxi in central China, south central China, in 1933 that the relationship with Mao really begins to solidify. Jiangxi, southern Jiangxi, was where the largest of the communist base areas was. And they had actually set up what they called the Jiangxi Soviet, a Soviet government, a Soviet-style, council-style government. And this was a great sort of laboratory where the party, they had about 10 million people just in this, you know, it's this remote area in the southern part of Jiangxi, but they still had about 10 million people. And so they were experimenting with things like land reform and debating gender issues and all kinds of policy initiatives. Zhou Enlai winds up going up there. Pressure in the cities, pressure in Shanghai was simply getting too dangerous. And he, by 1933, beginning in 1934, Zhou actually emerges as the effective leader of the Jiangxi Soviet. Mao Zedong is sort of the military, main military figure, but Zhou Enlai politically is running the organization department, which is, of course, always one of the key positions. But it's during this time, seeing what's going on in the Jiangxi Soviet, and of course talking with Mao and reflecting, I suppose you would say, on the experiences of the 20s, that I think this is when Zhou Enlai really works through in his own thinking that Mao's right, that Mao's perspective on the nature of the revolutionary struggle is the correct one. And that, that's the path that China eventually is going to have to follow. That takes a little time to sort of work itself into practice, partly because the pressure of the nationalists who ran these what they called extermination campaigns against the Jiangxi Soviet was steadily increasing. And so they were in a very defensive position, and Zhou's organizational skills were, of course, heavily in demand to maintain the struggle. And of course, in the end, by the fall of 1934, that pressure reaches a breaking point, and they realize that they can't stay there anymore. And this is what leads to the famous Long March, the breakout from Jiangxi that sets off then for the following year, thousands of miles of struggle, tens of thousands of people lost along the way in fighting or disease or whatever. But it's very early in the Long March, in January of 1935, when they pause in Guizhou province at a town called Zunyi. And they have a meeting, an expanded standing committee of the Political Bureau, to talk about, you know, where are we going, what are we doing, how are we going to go forward from here. And it's at that meeting that Zhou Enlai throws his support, his considerable political support, behind Mao Zedong, And Mao emerges as the effective leader of the party. He doesn't actually become chairman of the party until, I believe it's the 8th Congress in 1945. But he now is the chairman of the military commission, and for all practical purposes, he from this point on is the leader. And Zhou Enlai, you know, the initial motions at the Zunyi meeting were for Zhou to take over as the party leader, but he defers to Mao, and they establish this working relationship, which then persists all the way down until 1976. But it's really it takes some time, and it's a result of Zhou reflecting on his own experience, the experience of the party, and seeing the effectiveness of Mao's line in the organizing work that's going on in Jiangxi. Once that alliance is consolidated, it never wavers, which isn't to say that they never had any disagreements or differences, but there's never a point at which they're going to fall, their relationship is going to fall apart.
Right. Yeah. Thanks. That's a fascinating history, and I think the politics that you've explained there is really absolutely crucial for people hoping to understand, you know, the overall trajectory of the Chinese Revolution. So, Zhou Enlai spoke several languages. He had traveled widely. He had, you know, sort of extraordinary, legendary personal charm. Was known to be a very intelligent person. He had these well-honed negotiating skills. And these characteristics obviously served him well as Minister of Foreign Affairs for the first decade or so of the People's Republic, and as the most recognizable face of Chinese diplomacy from 1949 or even pre-1949 until his death in 1976. So he exerted this huge influence on Socialist China's foreign policy. Can you describe the outlines of that policy, in particular in relation to the five principles of peaceful coexistence and China's enduring orientation towards the global South? You know, it's focused on anti-imperialism. You know, what contribution do you think those foreign policy doctrines and practice have made to Marxist theory on the question being developed, you know, from the standpoint of a country that had been oppressed by imperialism, and also at a time when it was becoming clear that different social systems, you know, specifically capitalism and socialism, would have to continue to coexist, you know, for a whole historic period.
Sure, sure. Yeah, I mean, Zhou Enlai, one of the things that everyone says about Zhou Enlai, whether it's his supporters or other people in the revolutionary movement, or I recently was reading a 1972 CIA now declassified sort of characterization of him, you know, in the context of the changing relationship with the United States. Even the CIA analysts talk about how he was this consummate sort of diplomatic figure, who, of course, during the Second United Front, he helped us to get the Second United Front going in 1936 with the Xi'an incident, and then during the war with Japan, he coordinated with the nationalists. After the war, before the Civil War really gets rolling in 1946-47, he's, you know, leading these negotiating teams with the Americans and all this, trying to create a coalition government. So he has that background. And then, of course, once liberation comes and the People's Republic is established, he becomes the prime minister, which he a position that he holds until his death in January of 76, and foreign minister until 1958. But really, he remains even after 58 as sort of the people often say, the face of China to the outside world. And probably the most important contribution that he makes, or legacy that he leaves, because it's still with us today, is this set of what are called the five principles of peaceful coexistence. And interestingly, a lot of these have just been restated in China's peace proposal around Ukraine, in the Global Security Initiative documents that came out a couple of weeks ago. And basically, the five principles are mutual respect for sovereignty and territorial integrity, mutual non-aggression, non-interference by states in each other's internal affairs, what's called equality and mutual benefit, the idea that that relationship shouldn't be based on one side taking advantage of the other, and simply the concept of peaceful coexistence, as you say, this recognition that that the revolution, even though certainly Zhou Enlai in China dedicated to the long-term transformation of the world, you know, the vision of a socialist and communist future remains at the heart of things. The recognition that that's not going to happen overnight, or even in a relatively short time frame. And so, in order to develop the country, in order to not just survive but to move along the path of building socialism, it was necessary to live in a world where countries weren't going to blow each other up, you know. And so these principles are first enunciated in the early 1950s. They pop up in agreements between China and India, China and Afghanistan, China and Indonesia, and they become characteristic of China's approach to international relations. And I think that that at the heart of this is the idea that that you know, I mean, China's revolution is both a domestic social revolution, but also profoundly a global anti-imperialist revolution. And that's the solidarity that these principles are designed to promote, the idea that that countries that have been exploited, oppressed by imperialism, they should have mutually beneficial and trustworthy relationships with one another. And they should demand that the imperialist powers, who are not going to go away in any immediate time frame, and here we are 70 some years later, still in the throes of anti-imperialist struggles, that these principles should be upheld in the face of ongoing efforts by the imperialists to try to perpetuate their systems of oppression and exploitation. So I think that they have become, for much of the world, not just socialist states, but for much of the world, much of the post-colonial, post-imperialist world, these guidelines have certainly persisted for China, and really, I think, been embraced by people in many, many countries around the world.
Indeed, and the world would be a much better place if the imperialist countries also followed those principles. Just going back to what you said about Zhou being kind of universally recognized for his abilities and his intelligence, well, Henry Kissinger, who is by no means a friend of socialism or the global working class, said about Zhou Enlai that, "I met no leader, with the exception of Charles de Gaulle, with an equal grasp of world events to that of Zhou Enlai." So, praise indeed, even if it's from a reactionary. So Zhou Enlai was a key participant in the Afro-Asian Conference of 1955 that was held in Bandung, which is, you know, very, very well known and widely understood to be a pivotal event in the development of global South unity and solidarity. What was the significance of Bandung, and what was Zhou's specific role?
Well, Zhou played a very critical role in the Bandung conference. Of course, China was not the organizer of this conference. This was figures like Nehru from India, Nasser from Egypt, Sukarno in Indonesia were probably some of the more important leaders. But China wished to express its support for and solidarity with these countries that were emerging from, in some instances, like Indonesia and India, centuries of colonial exploitation. And to say, you know, we're with you, you know, we're on your side, we share your concerns. We too in China have liberated ourselves from imperialist exploitation, and we are pursuing our particular path, but we recognize that that other countries will have their particular paths, and we should unite around the things which we share and try to help each other out in whatever ways we can. So Zhou Enlai leads the Chinese delegation to Bandung. which is on the island of Java, just outside of Jakarta, the capital of Indonesia. And of course, this is 1955. Indonesia has been independent for less than 6 years when the Bandung Conference takes place. India for what, 8 years? Egypt, still kind of struggling with British control, British and French control over the Suez Canal. It's a time where post-colonial countries are really just beginning to emerge. Most of Africa still under colonial rule. People from many of the African countries, many of the liberation movements, come to Bandung. So it's a moment where Zhou Enlai makes a very critical speech at the conference. A number of leaders at the non-aligned conference were a little anxious about China and about Zhou's role. Of course, this was right at the height of the Cold War, and I think there was some concern that China, which at that point, of course, was very strongly, closely allied with the Soviet Union, might be, pushing a hard line about supporting the Soviet Union. China had also enunciated its own stance of what Zhou called leaning to one side, again, in their relationship with the Soviet Union. And Zhou Enlai was concerned that, that this might become a divisive element at both at Bandung and in the future of the non-aligned movement. So he makes this very important speech in which he really emphasizes the principles of coexistence that we were just talking about. And the idea that countries will respect each other. That's the first of the principles, mutual respect for sovereignty and territorial integrity. And sovereignty means that countries get to organize themselves the way that they choose, not according to someone else's diktats, whether it's the imperialists or China or whoever. And he was a very effective speaker. He was very charismatic individual, and he is able to reassure the leaders, the participants at the non-aligned conference, that China's intentions were beneficent, if you will, that it was a matter of solidarity amongst the former victims of imperialism, and that China was not trying to impose its path on others, but would follow its path and was unapologetic about its socialist agenda for China, but wasn't going to try to shove this, down the throats of other countries that would find their own paths to a better future, hopefully. So, it was a great display of his diplomatic skills and his interpersonal skills, if you will, both in talking, to other leaders at the conference, but also in this very important speech that worked very well to allow Bandung to come to a successful conclusion and become sort of the launch of this non-aligned movement.
Right. And an interesting side note in relation to Zhou Enlai at Bandung is that the Kuomintang security services in Taiwan attempted to assassinate Zhou on his way to Bandung.
Yes.
So from December 1963 to February 1964, Zhou Enlai led an extended delegation to 10 African countries, which were Egypt, Algeria, Morocco, Tunisia, Ghana, Mali, Guinea, Sudan, Ethiopia, and Somalia. Zhou met with legendary figures such as Kwame Nkrumah, Ben Bella, and Jamal Abdel Nasser. And that was the first visit by a top Chinese leader to Africa. To what extent did that visit set the tone for China-Africa relations in the following decades, really up to and including the present day?
Well, that is the launch. That is the moment where by 1963-64, more and more countries in Africa are able to free themselves from British and French, primarily, colonial rule. And becoming independent, some of them through armed struggle, as in Kenya, some of them through political negotiation, some of them through the exhaustion of British imperialism and its inability to sustain itself. So it was a moment where Africa was starting to find its way forward. Many different African countries were starting to look to a new future. China by this point was also, you know, having its differences with the Soviet Union. And I think Zhou Enlai was eager to demonstrate again, as he had spoken at Bandung, that China was eager to be a friend to countries that were trying to get on their own two feet after being freed from imperialist domination. And, you know, setting a tone of what can we do to help? How can we work together? Not that China, you know, was a you know, could be like a wealthy donor. You know, China's relationships have been, you know, always been aimed at mutual benefit. But not to come in as, you know, as a either for a new form of exploitation or even for political manipulation, that what they were looking for were relationships with countries going forward that would you know, that would work to the benefit of both sides. And of course, some of the great outcomes of this, some of the things, the building of the Tanzan Railway that gets underway later in 1964, comes to be kind of a model for China's engagement with Africa, where, you know, they go in and they build infrastructure for the countries involved, not the way that you know, that the British or the French or others, you know, built infrastructure so that they could extract resources from those countries. Incorporate them in as subordinate components of an imperial system focused on the metropolis, but instead, you know, to help these countries develop infrastructure that would allow them to, you know, pursue their own path of development, their own modernization, if you will, and that I think has remained characteristic. Certainly, you know, we can see the legacy of that with the Belt and Road Initiative today. With other bilateral relationships that China has. China hosts every year meetings in Beijing for African leaders from all over the continent who come there. So I think that yeah, the Africa tour in 63-64 is the launch pad, if you will, for that ongoing relationship. It of course has had its ups and downs, and China has had its periods where it's been more or less able to provide assistance. But certainly at this point, China is very dedicated to a new era of multinational, you know, non-imperial globalization, if you will, through things like the Belt and Road Initiative.
Yeah, I'm sure you're familiar with Deborah Brautigam's book called The Dragon's Gift.
Of course.
And kind of covering, you know, the long range of people's China's relationship with Africa. And I think she makes a really important point and demonstrates that, you know, the forms of Chinese engagement with Africa have changed somewhat. You know, there's much less focus on aid these days than there had been, and much more focus on trade and investment. But the substance of the engagement in terms of encouraging infrastructure development, in terms of kind of leveraging and showcasing China's experience, its own experience in breaking out of development to help other countries in Africa and really across the global south to break out of underdevelopment, that's really been a constant theme in that relationship. So jumping forward a decade or so, Zhou Enlai led the Chinese side in negotiations with Henry Kissinger and his team in 1971, and that led to President Nixon's visit a year later in 1972, then the signing of the Shanghai Communique, and the development of diplomatic and economic exchanges between the US and China, and finally in 1979, under the Carter administration, the establishment of bilateral relations. Many on the West, including on the left, possibly including even yourself, were sort of quite surprised by these developments, by this rapprochement between the US and China. What in your view, prompted the Chinese leadership to engage with the US at that time? And conversely, what prompted the US leadership to engage with the Chinese?
Well, it was a dramatic moment, certainly to say the least. And I remember being quite taken aback, if you will, by the news. And of course, when President Nixon does finally go in February of 1972, and these these television images of the president's motorcade, you know, going from Capital Airport down into Beijing, and then the scenes of his activities there, both in Beijing and later in Shanghai, this was it was disorienting. I think is a good way to think of it. It was quite an unanticipated shock for many people, not just on the left certainly, but you know, for us as well. Yeah, the calculus that leads to that dramatic moment, I think, interestingly, works. There are some common elements on both the American and the Chinese side, which, you know, the relationship between China and the Soviet Union had followed a rather tortuous path. They had signed this treaty of friendship and cooperation back in 1950, for which Zhou Enlai had been the lead negotiator. Chairman Mao had visited Moscow, but Zhou Enlai had done the sort of diplomatic heavy lifting, if you will. And in the 50s, that relationship worked reasonably well. The Soviet Union provided a great deal of assistance and technical advice, not again as a giveaway. This wasn't a welfare program, and China had to repay loans and all kinds of things like that. But it certainly played a very important role in getting industrialization going and getting military modernization going and things like that. But especially after the 20th Party Congress in 1956 in the Soviet Union and Khrushchev's denunciation of Stalin, China, Mao in particular, but other Chinese leaders as well, became increasingly concerned that the Soviet and the Chinese paths and perspectives were a little different, to say the least. That erupts in a full sort of split in 1959, 1960 during the Great Leap Forward. The Soviet leadership saw that as adventurism, and they didn't approve, and they withdrew their technical advisors and shut down construction projects and called in the loans and all this at a time when China was facing some fairly severe internal difficulties and challenges as well. So the relationship soured. In the early 60s, the two parties exchanged a series of polemical letters, and Zhou Enlai played a very strong role in the composition of those, setting out their differences, still at that point articulating those as differences of opinion between fraternal parties. But as the 60s progressed, and especially during the Cultural Revolution, the relationship really, really became antagonistic. And on the Chinese side, apparently, and we still don't have as much, sort of documentary detail as historians would like, but it's pretty clear that Mao and others reassessed in a theoretical mode what we would call the primary contradiction. They had seen the primary contradiction for China in global affairs as that between the Chinese, the revolution, the socialist camp, and Western imperialism led by the United States. But by this time, by 1969, when the Ninth Party Congress takes place and the Cultural Revolution is sort of in some way sort of wound up with a new Central Committee and all this, this was at this same time there were actually military clashes with the Soviet Union along the long border between the two countries. And that seems to have finally convinced much of the leadership, not all of it, but much of the leadership, that the Soviet Union now constituted more of a direct threat to China than the United States. The United States, of course, was bogged down in Vietnam, was losing its effort to take over from French imperialism there, was being defeated by the Vietnamese people, and was facing, of course, a significant political turmoil at home, the Black Liberation Struggle, the anti-war movement, other kinds of radical and progressive political agitation in the country. There are deep political divisions here. And so Mao and others saw the United States now as a weakening force. And so the decision was made to open up, to accept initiatives from the United States in order to upset the existing sort of balance of power. From the Chinese point of view, a phrase that you hear, to sort of play the American card, to offset what they saw as the threat from the Soviet Union. For the Americans, it was essentially sort of the same calculus in reverse, that the Soviet Union coming out of the 50s and through the 60s had achieved significant economic development. Although Khrushchev and later Brezhnev, pursued their own politics of peaceful coexistence, the rivalry was still strong, and the Soviet Union's performance was improving. The economic situation in the country. It wouldn't be until Reagan came along with his new arms race to try to bankrupt the Soviet Union that things kind of go off the rails again. But they felt the American leadership, Nixon and Kissinger in particular, were very anxious about the Soviet Union, and looking for a way perhaps out of Vietnam as well. They thought that perhaps opening a relationship with China would be a good thing. I don't think that the Americans ever quite had understood the nature of the divisions between China and the Soviet Union. Certainly they didn't take that seriously for a long time. But I think that for Nixon, playing the China card, the idea was to ensure that there wasn't a united front of the Soviet Union and China against the United States, which of course the Biden administration is trying to do again today in very different circumstances. That sort of geostrategic concept still has some relevance today. So both sides, both the Americans and the Chinese, were seeking to reconfigure global geopolitical relationships in ways which each of them thought would be advantageous, and certainly for at least a while, that seems to have been not an unreasonable conclusion for them to draw.
Absolutely. It's one of the great ironies of history that it took one of the most reactionary, more or less far right regimes in US history to bring about some level of rapprochement with China. And certainly in terms of how the Sino-Soviet split fed into that, I think, economically speaking, China found itself in a difficult situation anyway, due to a number of internal factors. B, it was facing essentially a double blockade. From 1949 onwards, it had been blockaded by the US. And then from the early 60s onwards, it was essentially blockaded by the Soviet Union as well. So economically, it was a real struggle. And, the idea of developing a trade relationship with the United States and importing some newer technologies was very important. And I think, there's a line between that and the opening up policy that was reformed, that was embarked upon by the Deng Xiaoping leadership in 1978.
Yeah, I think that's true. And I think that of course, it wasn't just the United States. American trade with China after 72, begins to develop, but normalizing or beginning the process of normalizing a relationship with the United States also allowed Japan to begin to invest directly in China. And certainly through the 70s, a lot more FDI came in from Japan than it does from the U.S. After 79, of course, and in the 80s, then the U.S. jumps in a much bigger way. But yeah, I think that economic component also is very important, that, you know, the need for, I mean, all that assistance from the Soviet Union had gone away, and the need for some sources, new sources of technology and capital, you know, that was a significant component of that rethinking as well.
Indeed. And then beyond economics, on the military side, what becomes pretty clear if you look at the documents of the CPC leadership, particularly in the Cultural Revolution periods, you know, in the late 60s, and stretching beyond the death of Mao in 76 and into the Deng Xiaoping leadership period, and really up until the early to mid 80s, is that the Chinese had felt very seriously under threat from the Soviet Union. They were seriously and genuinely concerned that the USSR could launch an invasion of China. There was, as you've mentioned, there were border conflicts. There was the, you know, huge buildup of Soviet troops in Mongolia. So, you know, rightly or wrongly, the Chinese felt very viscerally that there was the possibility of invasion and that they needed to do something to improve their geostrategic position.
Yeah.
So, because we like to win friends and influence people, let's also talk about the Cultural Revolution. You know, the Cultural Revolution is one of the most controversial episodes in modern Chinese history. Now, Zhou Enlai was mistrusted and I think disliked, it's fair to say, by some of the leading protagonists in the Cultural Revolution. But in spite of that, he managed to escape sort of direct persecution. Although, as you know, his adoptive daughter, Sun Weishi, tragically died in prison during that period. How did Zhou manage to come through the whole period sort of relatively unscathed, and what was his role?
Well, the Cultural Revolution period for Zhou Enlai was a very difficult one in many ways. I mean, as it was for people, you know, in different political positions at different times. It was, you know, Chairman Mao talked about great turmoil under heaven and, you know, bombarding the headquarters and things like that. You know, I mean, I think that the Cultural Revolution, at its best, if you will, was an effort to address the problems of bureaucratization, of alienation of the party from the masses, and to encourage a reinvigoration of the relationship between ordinary people and the Communist Party, and in many ways. I think that that those objectives were pursued and to some extent were achieved, but it was also a period of great upheaval. There was a lot of struggle, and you know, many challenges were faced. And in the course of that, relationships that had existed amongst the leadership within the party and at lower levels as well. But we know, you know, a lot about the figures at the higher levels. Some of those relationships that went back decades, you know, came apart, and people who had worked very closely together and who had found ways to navigate whatever differences of opinion or perspective they may have had, reached a point where those contradictions became antagonistic, if you will, to use some of Mao's theoretical language. Zhou Enlai had to navigate very carefully. He was, in many ways, you know, the ironies kind of layer upon one another, because, of course, he was in some ways the consummate bureaucrat, but perhaps in the best sense of a bureaucrat, in the sense of being good at organizing, good at managing, good at getting things done, rather than the negative side of bureaucratization, which is, you know, sort of rigidity and commandism and things like that. He was always a facilitator, always a negotiator, always seeking to bring clashing positions into some sort of reconciliation. And the Cultural Revolution certainly tested those skills, not quite to the breaking point, but sometimes pretty close. I think that the personal trust that Mao and Zhou had for one another is a key factor in this, that even though we know from transcripts of various kinds that there were meetings where Mao criticized even Zhou Enlai, Zhou Enlai, though, I think really embodied, had very much embraced the principles of things like criticism and self-criticism, the idea that you don't want to just be ego invested in your power and your position in even in a particular political position or political policy, something like that. And he was able to accept criticism. He was able to criticize himself in situations where he recognized, perhaps, positions he had taken or people he had either supported or criticized. Maybe, he didn't think of himself as infallible. He recognized that, it's a process, to say the least. There's people that criticize Zhou Enlai for being too loyal to Mao. He's often portrayed in the context of the Cultural Revolution as a moderator or a protector. Very famously, of course, he sent forces from the sort of bodyguard troops of the leadership to protect the Palace Museum, the Forbidden City, to protect the Lama Temple in Beijing. They were closed down for 10 years, but they were not ransacked or destroyed or something like that, and they are still, of course, with us today. And did the same for individuals, when he could and when he felt that was justifiable and viable. But he was also involved in the criticism of people with whom he had worked for many years, and some of whom, either met unfortunate fates or in some instances took their own lives in this very tumultuous period of struggle. So he has certainly people who have been critical of him, although I think overall the assessment of Zhou Enlai historically by ordinary people in China is that he was a force for moderation and stability, even while understanding, appreciating, and supporting the positive goals of the Cultural Revolution, but clearly a very difficult time to navigate.
Absolutely, I think that's well put. And I think it's pretty uncontroversial these days to assess the Cultural Revolution and say that it went too far in many ways. It was problematic in many ways. It went beyond the bounds that the leadership had originally conceived of for it. And yet, I think to some degree, probably to quite a significant degree, the Cultural Revolution sought to served to set certain parameters for what could happen afterwards. Yeah. So for example, probably without the Cultural Revolution, we wouldn't have had the four cardinal principles, which essentially say, yes, we're opening up some markets, we're opening up to foreign investment, but we're going to keep the Communist Party in charge. We're going to keep on the socialist road. We're going to keep adhering to Marxism, Leninism, Mao Zedong thought. And that's very important because it's not that difficult to imagine that with the process of reform and opening up, you could have a level of ideological deterioration that you had in the Soviet Union that would have led to the collapse of the People's Republic in the same way as in 1991 we had the collapse of the Soviet Union. So in that sense, that is an important part of the legacy of the Cultural Revolution. And another thing which is kind of ironic, it's a point that Isabella Weber makes in her book, How China Avoided Shock Therapy. She says that the sent down youth that were sent down during the period of the Cultural Revolution to work in the countryside, they sort of formed the basis of the new generation of economists under reform and opening up, who had, you know, a particularly strong understanding of and connection with the peasantry, which had to, you know, to some degree been lost in the first 20, 30 years of the Chinese Revolution, the, you know, the relationship between the radical youth and the peasantry. So right. It's kind of ironic that that experience would turn them into reform economists, but there you go. It's an interesting history. So starting from the early 1960s, Zhou Enlai spoke several times about the importance of what he called the four modernizations of agriculture, of industry, of defense, and of science and technology in terms of allowing China to break out of underdevelopment and to construct, you know, a prosperous modern socialism. Deng Xiaoping then made the four modernizations really the cornerstone of the whole reform and opening up strategy from 1978. To what degree do you think that Zhou's ideas on this, on socialist modernization, represent sort of a bridge between the two main phases of people's China? That is, the first three decades of socialist construction and the reform period from 1978.
Well, I think that's a very good way to think of it, is as a bridge. We should remember again that Zhou's relationship with Deng Xiaoping went all the way back to France in the early 1920s, and that they had worked together in founding the communist organization, the Chinese Communist Organization there. There's no doubt that when Deng Xiaoping emerges in November of 78 as the principal effective leader of the party and of becomes the reform movement, that represents the beginning of a new era, a new phase in China's struggle for a socialist future. But it doesn't, as Chairman Mao says, it doesn't fall from the sky. It's not something that is a complete and total rupture with what went before. And that period of the 70s, where both Zhou Enlai and Deng Xiaoping are talking about the four modernizations, are talking about the ways in which it's time to build upon what has already been accomplished. But what has been accomplished has been to create a society that was much more equitable, much more, had sort of built up, if you will, it's not always the best image, but the sort of safety net, improved people's life expectancy, reduced infant mortality, developed healthcare, especially in the countryside, the barefoot doctors, all that kind of stuff. China had achieved great things, but it was a sort of socialism of poverty. It was an egalitarianism of poverty. And that's not what socialism is all about. Socialism is about abundance. It's about, achieving a level of material prosperity that allows people to have a good life and to pursue, as Marx always said, the full realization of each individual. that's difficult to do in conditions of scarcity. So how could that be done? How could China put itself on a path to develop its material economy more rapidly and more effectively? And again, as we were just saying, with the very decision to open up to the United States, there was already a recognition of that need for new sources of investment, new sources of technology, for a greater access to leading sectors in development. And that gets underway in the 70s. Although there are still, there's still political struggle going on within the party until certainly the end of 76, 77. But I think that when Deng Xiaoping finds himself in the position of being able to go forward with the reform projects and with the modernizations, that is a continuation, an intensification of the kind of efforts that Zhou Enlai had been talking about over the previous decade, at least, and as we have seen, and I think as you were just saying quite correctly, that the key is to is to have the party as the vanguard of the working class, if you will, have the party be the guiding force, be the guiding hand, so that you have capitalists in China now, but you don't have a capitalist system. You have, people who, there is private wealth and private capital, but they don't form a class that dominates the state and people's lives. It's still a work in progress. It's still a venture, if you will. I sometimes call it a quest for a socialist future. But it is an extension and a continuation of the revolutionary process and the process of socialist construction that was guided by Zhou Enlai and other leaders through those first three decades and carried on now in new forms and in some ways more intense forms right down to the present day.
Yeah, and this is a point that Xi Jinping has brought up consistently over the course of 10 plus years, which is about rejecting historical nihilism. You know, he makes this point that there are two key phases in China's revolution. There's the first three decades of socialist construction, and then there's the reform period from 1978, which we're still essentially in. But we don't reject either of them. We uphold both of them because they're both, you know, essential components, you know, and we wouldn't have one without the other.
Right.
And, you know, that links to something that Deng Xiaoping famously said as well in his interview with Oriana Fallaci, which was, you know, Chairman Mao's portrait will always be there in Tiananmen Square. We won't do to Mao what Khrushchev said did to Stalin. You know, that is to say, you know, we recognize that some mistakes were made, and we recognize that we're going to do certain things differently, but we don't reject what happened previously. We don't reject our history. And I think that idea has been quite important to the survival of the Chinese Revolution.
Yes, absolutely.
So could you say something briefly about the April 1976 Tiananmen incident and the suppression of public mourning after Zhou Enlai's death? Why was Zhou so deeply mourned by the Chinese people? And why were there some people in the CPC that were opposed to this?
Well, the Zhou Enlai dies in January of 1976. He had been very ill. He had cancer. And by that point, by the fall of 75, you know, it had spread. And he really, for the last 2 years of his life, essentially lived at the Capitol Hospital, able to go out and attend meetings from time to time and to receive visitors down till the early fall of 75. But he needed constant medical attention, and he finally succumbed and went to see Karl Marx in January of 76. And then at the beginning of April, April 5th is what's called the Qingming Festival, which is a traditional Chinese moment to express your respect for the ancestors and to honor them. And it had historically, since liberation, been a moment when people went to Tiananmen Square, to the monument to the heroes of the revolution, to do the same thing, to express, to see those heroes of the revolution in a sense as part of their ancestral legacy, their ancestral inheritance. And in 76, when the Qingming Festival came along, tens of thousands of people went to the square and put out bouquets and wreaths and banners praising Zhou Enlai, expressing their affection, their respect for the premier, and mourning his passing. Among those, the most prominent of those figures within the CPC who were not well disposed towards Zhou Enlai were the figures that were sometimes referred to as the Gang of Four: Zhang Qing, Yao Wenyuan, Zhang Chunqiao, and Wang Hongwen. They saw Zhou in many ways as the consummate bureaucrat, and they were their view was that his pragmatism, his sort of diplomatic posture, the actions that he had taken to moderate and protect people and things during the Cultural Revolution were bad. They saw those as being obstructions to their particular political orientation. And so they were very hostile to this expression of reverence and support for Zhou Enlai that was taking place at Tiananmen Square. So they sent, they got the police in the capital to go there and sort of clear people out. People were not happy about that. They fought with the police. A couple of police cars were overturned. There was a bit of a dust up. And at first, because Chairman Mao was very ill at this time himself, Zhang Qing, as his wife, was able to manipulate things and have the demonstrations at Tiananmen Square declared a counter-revolutionary incident. Later, after Chairman Mao's death in September, and then the arrest of those four leaders and a few others in October, that position was reversed, and it was not seen as a counter-revolutionary incident, but as a patriotic incident supporting Zhou Enlai. And the reason I think underlying that is this popular perception, this perception on the part of many ordinary people, that in fact Zhou Enlai was a figure who tried to navigate the difficult waters of the Cultural Revolution, to protect people when that was possible, and to defend sort of calmer, more rational approaches. That he wasn't always successful at that, and that was not certainly, it wasn't a one-dimensional thing on his part, but that he was a, to put it in its simplest way, he was a good guy. And they trusted him, and they admired him, and they respected him. And that found its expression in those events.
Got you. Thanks. Very interesting. Now, it's an interesting fact that in North Korea, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, there is only one single statue of a foreigner, and that is the statue of Zhou Enlai in the industrial city of Hamhung. What do you think the reason is for that singular honor?
Well, I think, the North Koreans, Zhou Enlai was already, of course, prime minister when the war of resistance to American aggression took place. China sent 600,000 people's volunteers to help the regime in the north to survive, and certainly without that assistance, that we probably wouldn't have a DPRK today, and who knows what American neocolonialism on the peninsula would have developed. So North Korea had historically had a close link with China, and Zhou Enlai played a key role in the policies of China's support for the Korean War. The Chinese were not eager to be drawn into that. They had just established the PRC. They were trying to get on their own two feet, but they would not abandon their allies that way. And Zhou's role as foreign minister and as prime minister was really central to the decisions that were made and the support that China provided to the DPRK, and that relationship was maintained over the remaining years of his life. And in fact, one of the last visitors that came to Zhou Enlai in the hospital in Beijing was Kim Il-sung, because they had been friends, they had known each other for decades. And Kim Il-sung came to Beijing, not solely to see Zhou Enlai, but for meetings, and made sure that he visited the premier in the hospital, to say goodbye to a long-term ally and a close friend. And I think that statue is a remarkable testament to the respect and the affection that people feel for Zhou Enlai, not only in China, but in many, many parts of the world as well.
Right, very interesting. I don't know if you can see, I've got a sheet of stamps here from a sheet of Korean stamps from 94 honoring Zhou Enlai.
There you go. Very
there's
good.
One with Kim Il-sung and Zhou Enlai there.
Yes.
Back in the 50s, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the last question is, how's Zhou Enlai thought of in China today, you know, 125 years after his birth? Is his what is his political legacy, and you know, is it still considered relevant? What significance does he have for today, not just in China, I suppose, but in the world?
Well, certainly in China, he still is a figure, a greatly respected and admired figure. Of course, the number of people who have sort of living memory of Zhou Enlai is much smaller now than it has been in the past, obviously. But I think even among young people, he is seen as a figure of balance, as a figure sort of common sense. I think that his role in the world, his role representing China globally, and the things that he stood for, the five principles and things like that, are widely admired by young people and embraced by young people today. I know that this, I think, may be some sort of indicator. You know, historical dramas are very popular on Chinese television and in the movies and all this. And many of them, the tales of the revolution and all that, Zhou Enlai plays a prominent role. So much so that the actors who portray Zhou Enlai often themselves become kind of cultural icons. And I remember at one point when I was living in Beijing for about a half a year, watching one of these series and reading articles in the local paper about the actor, because when he would make public appearances, people would flock to see him, in a sense, just to sort of have a secondhand encounter with Zhou Enlai. So I think that kind of legacy really, really persists quite strongly. After his death, there was a huge explosion in publications, of biographies and personal recollections, narratives of sort of like My Dinner with Zhou Enlai kind of stuff, and a lot of that still persists. He's still a figure that is spoken of and referred to, I think, generally in very positive terms. No one is universally loved and embraced, but I think that his reputation and his historical position in China certainly has held up very, very well. In the world, I think that, a lot of people, to the extent that people know anything about China, a lot of people will know about Zhou Enlai. And I think that especially in the developing world, in the post-colonial, post-imperialist world, that there's a lot of memory of the things that he did. Even in a country like India, which has had a sometimes problematic relationship with China, where there have been tensions, sometimes conflicts on the border between the two countries, that the principles of peaceful coexistence and the reasonable face of China that Zhou Enlai represented are still remembered and respected. Again, not universally, certainly, but by many people. And I think that's true in Africa and Latin America and in other parts of Asia, probably to a significant extent, even in the West.
Absolutely. Well, we've covered a lot of ground today. I just wanted to ask quickly, if people want to find out more and do some reading, have you got any recommendations? So you can possibly see on the shelf behind me,
I do see several volumes.
I've got a volume of selected works. So there's the Han Su-yin biography, Elder Son, which is a great book.
And that is a good one.
A very nice volume called My Uncle Zhou Enlai. Any others that you recommend?
Well, let me see here. I got my stack right back here. Oh, there's Che Jin Lee's book, Zhou Enlai, The Early Years. This is a good, you know, we started out talking about his path to the revolution, and that's a very good study of that. And this is a funny little volume by a man named John McCook Roots, just called Zhou. But his father was a diplomat in Wuhan during the years that that Zhou Enlai was active there during the First United Front. And then after liberation, went back and visited China several times. And this is it's a very affectionate account of Zhou Enlai's career. So that's another good one. But there's no shortage of works. Not all of them particularly sympathetic. There's one called Zhou Enlai, China's Gray Eminence. That's a little grim in some of its assessments, but I think that you know, people can find some worthwhile things, and in a perhaps moment of shameless self-promotion, I'll mention that I'm working on a biography of him myself, which I hope will be coming out from Manchester University Press sometime in the not immediate but not too distant future.
Fantastic. Well, Professor Ken Hammond, we've taken a lot of your time, but it's been, you know, a great privilege to be able to draw on this, you know, incredibly extensive knowledge and very deep understanding of Chinese history. So thank you so much for joining us today. And I very, very much hope we'll work together again soon.
I definitely hope so, too. And it's wonderful to be able to share this celebration of Zhou Enlai's birthday with you and with whoever is tuning in to see us. So thanks for having me.